Roxana, thank you very much for the kind invitation to this fantastic symposium. So in 10 minutes, I have selected three challenges for the new P2Y12 antagonist. So let's start with the first one, the challenge of emergency. And we published the Atlantic study, as you may know, with Takagelo. Patients were randomized to receive the drug pre-hospital or in-hospital in the cath lab at the time of PCI. There was no difference between the two strategies when looking at coronary perfusion before PCI, but after PCI, there was a reduction of stent thrombosis, as shown here, and a reduction of ischemic events after PCI during the first 24 hours. So clearly, there was an advantage of early ticagrelor in this situation of STEMI patients undergoing primary PCI. More stable patients, it's a different situation. And stable coronary patients and non-ST elevation ACS, we have actually three studies, three randomized studies that looked at pretreatment versus no pretreatment. None of the three studies showed a benefit on the ischemic side. CREDO, PRAGATE, and the ECHO study, the largest study that we performed, 4,000 patients. But all the studies showed an increase in bleeding complications. So clearly, a non-ST elevation ACS is a different animal, and we still have discussion around the utility of pretreatment in these patients. We may want in many circumstances to wait for the coronary angiogram. So clearly, there are clinical situations where administration of antiplatelet therapy is delayed. Intubated patient, dysphagia or vomiting patients, STEMI patients when you do not have a pre-hospital system or when you are not able to deliver drugs with the paramedics. And of course, the situation that I just described of non-ST elevation ACS patient not receiving pretreatment. So what can we do? And actually, we have a number of studies now, small studies that have looked at different way of giving this new P2Y12 antagonist. You can crush the pills, you can chew ticagrelor also, and the data are pretty consistent to show that actually when you do that, you have a more rapid absorption, probably a better efficacy of the drug by chewing ticagrelor or crushing ticagrelor. Same here on the right side for prasugrel when you crush prasugrel. So this is now routine practice at our institution to give the drug this way, to crush the pills or to chew the pills. Another way to improve things is probably to use ticagrelor with this oral dispersible tablet, with water, without water, or in the nasogastric tube. You get the same results, rapid effect, and it's certainly an easy way to deliver antiplatelet therapy in emergency situations. You can also use IV P2Y12 inhibitors like Kangrelor. It was mentioned before by Deepak Bhatt, and it can do the job. It's more expensive, but actually you have a fast onset of action, and it's one way to do it in emergency situations, and of course you have to take care of the transition afterwards to the old new P2Y12 antagonist. And the last point, we may want to go upstream in the chain of care delivered to the patients. And there is one potent, very potent P2Y12 antagonist developed by Actelion. And the idea now is to ask the patient to inject themselves with this P2Y12 antagonist when they have the symptoms of a heart attack, and to abort the heart attack. So we'll see what comes out of this strategy, but it's a very interesting one when we ask the patients now to make the diagnosis and to inject the drug themselves subcutaneously. The second challenge is about the duration of the APT, something that we have mentioned before at this symposium. How short can be the APT duration? We have at least two beautiful trials, the ZEUS trial and the LIDERS 3 trial, showing that you can probably apply the rule that we have had for years with bare metal stents, 1 month therapy in these patients. And both studies recruited ACS patients, both studies had high bleeding risk patients. And when you do that, you have a better outcome with a drug-eluting stent and a short duration here, 1 month of the APT. So, of course, this is a selected population at high bleeding risk. How can this apply to other patients? clearly it needs to be studied. We have new generation of stents with rapid coverage of the struts, and you have here one example with the Cobra stent. And of course, when you have a rapid coverage of your struts, you can imagine to reduce more the duration of the APT, maybe 2 weeks and not even a month. And we have a couple of studies ongoing looking at the short duration of the APT with this type of stents. And last but not least, the new technology. This is a technology developed by a French startup company, and you have sensors powered by induction, which are placed on the struts of these stents, and you can know externally without any invasive approach. You can know externally if this stent is covered and by what the struts are covered. Is that clot? Is that cells? What kind of cells? And clearly, this is probably the good option to know when the struts are covered and when you can stop the APT. So these stents now are reaching the patient. Third challenge, the one of de-escalation, and I would like to show you a few recent studies that go into that direction. First study actually is a dose de-escalation that was tested in Japan with Prasugrel. And actually, the dose of Prasugrel here is much lower than the dose that we use in our patients. The loading dose is 20 milligrams. The maintenance dose is 3.75. It has been compared here to clopidogrel, and you can see that you have actually better control of platelet reactivity in these Japanese patients with a low dose of Prasugrel. Does that work in terms of clinical outcomes? Actually, it appears to work. If you compare here PrasFit ACS to Triton, you have similar curves, similar reduction of events on the ischemic side, and what you see is that in terms of major bleeding, you do not see the excess of bleeding complications that were that was observed in the Triton study. It's encouraging. The study is certainly too small. It has not been tested in Caucasian patients, but clearly this is possibly one way to go in terms of de-escalation. The second study I would like to mention is the Antarctic study. Actually, it was not a de-escalation study. It was a study where we gave on one side Prasugrel 5 milligrams to all patients, elderly patients, and all these patients had an ACS, and they were implanted with a drug-eluting stent. And the second group here of patients was monitored with platelet function testing, and we wanted to adjust the dose of Prasugrel according to what we got with a very fine hour. So the dose of Prasugrel could be increased in terms of high platelet reactivity, or we could change Prasugrel to clopidogrel in terms of safety when we had too high platelet inhibition. At the end of the day, actually, we had 40% of patients downgraded to clopidogrel 75 milligrams, and very few patients actually upgraded to Prasugrel 10 milligrams. So it's a sort of de-escalation study when you know the type of adjustment that was performed in Antarctic. And as you know, with this de-escalation, we did not observe any difference in terms of net clinical benefit, in terms of ischemic endpoint, and in terms of bleeding endpoint. So you may see that as a positive result of de-escalation, actually, you had the same results in terms of ischemic protection, and bleeding was roughly the same using clopidogrel rather than Prasugrel in this study. And the third study has been mentioned already. This is a topic study, ACS patients undergoing PCI. 1 month later, you switch the new P2Y12 antagonist to clopidogrel in one arm. You continue with the new P2Y12 inhibitors in the other arm, and you know the results. An impressive difference in this small study, 600 patients, certainly underpowered. The difference is mainly driven by a difference in minor bleedings. But, you know, it generates a new hypothesis concerning de-escalation. So this is a list of studies that are ongoing looking at these de-escalation strategies. Of course, it makes sense, particularly in the elderly patients, and we have two ongoing studies in the elderly. And we have a few more looking at de-escalation according to platelet function testing or genetic testing. And we will see also the tropical ACS study pretty soon. So the concept is correct. I would like to conclude by saying that we have made incredible progress in the past 15 years with antiplatelet therapy, but the timing and mode of administration are evolving in emergency situations. The duration of DAPT has not found a simple answer so far, and we need to work more on this question. And the concept of de-escalation acutely and de-escalation chronically is still being evaluated. We may have new strategies in the future for this patient. Thank you very much.